I have a little opportunity here. I might amend this to another video, or I might just make it a separate video. I don't have much time. But it's Sunday, and I have some time to really tape and focus in here. And while I have it, you know, have this push here, it's very important. A couple of things. Ecumenicalism is very important. Very important. In the simplification, we have to stop factionalism in our minds. Stop it just right in its tracks. Okay. So I can help with this. I'm very ecumenical. I spent my whole life giving full attention to all these great traditions, full attention. What are they really saying? They're all saying the same thing. They're all saying the same thing at the highest level. And it's interesting, like Buddhism has these two divisions, Hinayana and Mahayana Buddhism. Hinayana is called Theravada sometimes, and they're slightly different. Hinayana is a gradualist approach of building up good qualities. It's pretty similar to Catholicism and Christianity, all right? Christianity has this divisions of Christianity and Protestantism, too. Very different. In Hinayana Buddhism, the idea is you may have many, many, countless rebirths until you're finally liberated. Whereas in Mahayana, the idea is liberation this lifetime. Catholicism, it says, well, you know, if you're good and you do good and try to be a good person, that you take the Eucharist, you're going to go to heaven and stay with Jesus there and have a good afterlife and that kind of thing. Oh, okay. It's similar. Protestantism is like we're going to be raptured with Jesus and dwell with him forever, and we're finished with this world. You know, it's a different emphasis, actually. Very different. So it's very similar to the differences in Hinayana and Mahayana Buddhism. Yana means vehicle, smaller vehicle, lesser vehicle, and greater vehicle is how they call it. And the Hinayana, the smaller, lesser vehicles, it's the pejorative term, Theravada is a better term, is the ideal is liberation. You liberate yourself and you're finished with this world. That's it. The Mahayana is the Bodhisattva ideal, where you are committed to coming back to this world infinitely until all beings are released from this horrible absurdity. That's why they call it samsara. It's really just absurdity, actually. Arrogance and absurdity. So they're supposed to come back as Buddha, supposed to be liberated and enlightened, and then they come back here to help out. That's the Mahayana ideal. So there's these differences there, and in Protestant and Catholicism, they also have some differences, but it's a little different than the Buddhist differences. In Catholicism, there's all these saints who are still helping us. Okay, so that's like a Bodhisattva sort of thing, like Saint Jude, for instance. Saint Jude is one of the most prominent saints, and I've gotten help from Saint Jude, and I do believe in Saint Jude. He's a Bodhisattva. He's a saint, and he does help out. There are just millions and millions of testimonies of Saint Jude helping people out. He's a brother of ours. He's an older brother. You know, this is a good way to look at these saints. They're just part of our family. We're all part of one family. Okay, this is very important to understand. We are just part of all one family, one spiritual family. Everyone is. And we all have equal status in that family, which is perfect status. We all are God being God. We all have perfect freedom. That can never change. But some of us have tried to pretend that freedom doesn't exist. Many of us have. And some have decided that they're through with that nonsense. And they have recovered their functionality, realizing, hey, I do have perfect freedom. Those are what we call the saints. In Buddhism, we call them the Bodhisattvas. Hinduism, they call them different terms. They might call it the gurus. The gurus or the satgurus or the rishis or the Bhagavans, and they have various terms. But it's the same. They have woken up to their true nature and said, oh, wow, I just tried to pretend that freedom didn't exist, but it still does. I'm still perfectly free. So they can be very, very helpful to us. But there are brothers in spirit. We call this generic term brothers in spirit. I'm not going to bifurcate it in this... in a way I don't like to, you know, he, she, every single time. That's stupid, okay? It's just brothers in spirit. Brothers mean this generic term, non-gendered term. It just works. I don't want to get into this political correctness thing, okay? It doesn't work. It doesn't work well. I really, really don't like those who keep doing that. You just let it rest, okay? We're not bodies. We're not genders. We're free. We're spirit. So we are all part of this one family. So St. Jude is part of that family, our family. We are related to him the way that we would be related to a sibling. We're all siblings in spirit. Let's put it that way. If you want to use a neutral term, you can say we're all siblings in spirit. Absolutely close, super close relations there as far as just close siblings in spirit. Absolutely we are. So when we ask St. Jude for help, it's just like asking your older sibling who knows how to do stuff, has the know-how. You, could you help me with this? You know, I don't. How do you do this? What am I missing here? The adjustments. Okay. Oh well, I have to just stay with this light because the adjustment thing is gone. That's fine. This is very lighted up. How do you help me? Can you help me with this? I need help. I'm still not. I still haven't realized my freedom, and I'm still playing these absurdist games with myself. You know, and so really, can you please help? St. Jude is the one of last resort. So it's very powerful. I'm praying to St. Jude, asking for help. I have his card there. I came across his card. It was lying in a trash heap. It was lying in a trash heap, and I said, what is this? And I picked it up, and it's like, wow, that's St. Jude. So I put it by my desk there. It's right there now. And so I turned to it occasionally and said, hey, St. Jude, we really need your help. Your siblings need your help. We're calling on you. So Catholics call on the saints, which is a good thing. Okay, Protestants don't. They go for Holy Spirit and Jesus, which is also a good thing. So there's no reason to get all upset about this, because the bodhisattvas, the saints, do help. Now, calling on Jesus, Holy Spirit, Jesus is you can't get any more powerful than that. That is true. You can't get any more powerful than that. But sometimes we also like to call on someone like St. Jude or a saint, and Buddhists will call on various bodhisattvas to help them out, right? Hindus will call on their various manifestations. They have quite an amount of Ganesh, you know, Ganesh, the elephant. They call on these various symbols that represent deities to them. For help. Yeah, we really need help. Okay. So here arrives this person, Jude, just arrives at my doorstep this morning while I'm taping. Very, very, very nice young man. He's like, wow. And I saw somebody I thought was St. Jude walking by with a staff, the way that, you know, he's depicted, actually, this wooden staff. It's to say, hey, St. Jude is very active right now. So don't feel odd to call on these saints and ask for their help. There are siblings who are more experienced than we are, who are capable of seeing through the absurdity that we're caught up in, and capable of helping us out. I need help in myriads of ways, actually. I'm really pinched because I go all in preparation. I spare nothing. I'm just do whatever I can do to try to be of service, because this is an emergency, and it's the most dire emergency in history right now, actually. Now, I'm saying that you either profess at this time clearly or you listen clearly. Those are the two roles that I see in society right now. I don't see any other roles, okay? If somebody thinks they have similar roles, then to me, they're just talking gibberish, okay? They're just in a state of temporary catatonic withdrawal, actually. And a lot of people are going to go into this catatonic withdrawal. Just in a cocoon, catatonic cocoon. We don't want to do that here. So, very clear roles here. Either you take on the role of being a very clear professor of the truth. You're professing the truth. You're professing clarity. You're professing the goal of simplicity. Simplify your belief system in the right direction. Okay, simplify it. Get clear all this junk out, put it into a future life. You'll deal with complexity. You'll deal with the belief in complexity in a different life. Simplify. Someone has to do that professing. As many as possible is good. Whoever can do it should do it. The others, if you can't do that clearly and adamantly, then you should listen clearly and adamantly. Okay? Those are the two rules that I see. I don't see any other rules. So there are those who have trained to profess adamantly. I certainly have trained that way. And there are some who have trained themselves to listen clearly. I hope. Certainly hope these videos are helping out. It really is very good training. Because when the discord comes and the turmoil and the distress from all angles, you'll say, oh, it's easy for me to listen to this. I've been doing it. I've been spending so much time at it. It's not so difficult. I can do this. You see what a benefit that is? It's called preparation. Don't wait until the discord comes from all angles before you start starting to prepare. Then it's too late. So Jesus told us, prepare ahead of time. Don't wait until it's too late. The foolish virgins, the 10 foolish virgins, the ones that didn't prepare, they were locked out of the wedding feast. They were locked out. They said, oh my gosh, okay, it's time to prepare. Oh, really? The wedding's now? Oh, okay, let me go to the market. And Jesus, it's too late. It's too late to go to the market. You had to have the oil in your lamps now. You already had to have the oil in your lamps. So, and another thing is, I find that Christians, there's some Christians who are, they're the most ecumenical people in the world. They really are. Now, people might think that Hindus are, but they're, what do Hindus know about Christianity, really? What do Buddhists know? Very little. I found they know very little, actually. They're patting themselves on the back saying, I'm so ecumenical. But what do they really know about Christianity in depth? I had never come across anyone who really knows at all. Hey, so be careful. I am very adamant in saying that some Christians, not all, of course, there's some that are very much closed-minded, okay? But the adversary, absurdity, uses them and say, look, see, this is what Christians are, and holds them up and tries to undermine all Christianity by doing that. But Christians can be very ecumenical. So we're not nearly as dumb as many people think we are, or as closed-minded or anything like that. Not at all. But let me make it very clear that we're not going to forsake Jesus or the Holy Spirit at all. And we don't need to. We don't need to. So I'm very keen on this. I understand the other traditions very well. And of course, right at this point, it's not wise to speak about Islam. Okay, I greatly respect Islam too. But there's too many sensitivities about that, and it's very confusing for people. So I don't bring that into the conversation. But I certainly understand that they can speak for themselves. There's a lot of wisdom there too. Okay, so a great deal, in spite of the superficial appearances of it, in spite of that. So Jesus doesn't take a back seat to anyone. Christianity doesn't take a back seat at all. But neither can we say that the other religions need to take a back seat either, actually. They certainly know what they're talking about also. This is what I've discovered. This is what I investigated. I said, what's really going on? And it's like, okay, they also don't take a back seat. So, you know, let's not anybody be on their high horse too much here. Let's point to the truth here. And let's not juggle for supremacy, so to speak. What's really supreme right now is ecumenical attitude, which is simplifying the whole thing. This is what's important right now. And so we don't waste energy. We don't get caught up. The adversary loves to divide and conquer. The adversary is absurdity, arrogance and absurdity. That's the adversary. It loves to divide and conquer. It loves to divide us, divide and conquer. So I like that, siblings in spirit. That's nice. It avoids both male and female, right? Siblings in spirit. We're just this one spiritual family, gender-free siblings in spirit, like very close, Absolute trust in one another. Absolute trust. As I experienced this. I experienced the one spiritual family. I've experienced. I'm talking from experience. And it's like we're all perfect. We have absolute perfect love for one another and perfect trust in one another. This is true. And this is what Jesus has told me, and it's absolutely true. Now, the Holy Spirit is all the religions speak of this in different terminology, but they're also, of course, very aware of the grace of God. And we can get more and more clarity from this Holy Spirit and help and help from it. We really can. And it's always clear. It never loses its clarity. It's not a body. It never incarnates. This is important. The Holy Spirit never takes on form. Never will. It can't be killed. It cannot be harmed. It cannot be blackmailed. It cannot be pressured in any way. So it's always available to us. And I cannot adjust this. Maybe I'm going to open this up again and see if I can adjust it. But it's good. More light is coming in. It can never be compromised. It's always available to us. Even when we're in the most severe travails, it's not. The Holy Spirit is not in any severe travails ever. I could turn these lights off. That might help. Let me do this. It's never in any problems. Okay, here comes the adjustment back up. See, you need to make adjustments as you go along, right in the midst of it all. You have to be of good cheer, really of good cheer here. And so we have this source of help that is never absent from us. Under any circumstances, it is never absent from us. I want to make this very clear. Doesn't matter how bad we're suffering, the Holy Spirit is not suffering. The Holy Spirit never suffers. It's always in this absolutely blissful clarity. Perfect blissful clarity, aware of everything that's going on all the way to the end of all belief in time. An entire belief system completely vanished, all the way to the complete vanishing of the belief system of absurdity, arrogance and absurdity. It already sees the entire vanishment of that. It's already done it. So it has absolute assurance. Unshakable. It's completely unshakable. We have that access to that. And the more we practice access to that, it's subtle. It's subtle. But we all have that within us. It's not some special saviors who have access to it. We all have access to it. Equal access. We just don't use it. Absurdity advises us not to. And so as long as we keep following the vice of absurdity, we won't be familiar with it. And if we're not familiar with it, we'll shy away from it. So again, absurdity, arrogance and absurdity, which the ego is a shorthand way of saying the ego, but that's more of a psychoanalytic term. I don't like using it that much. It advises us not, and it uses this problem of continuity and familiarity against us constantly. And unless we focus on that problem and break that habit, then we are still spinning our wheels. Always it uses familiarity against us and says, oh, well, yeah, that's great, but and then tries to push us too far, too high, too fast, and then we shrink away from that and says, oh, you see, the Holy Spirit's not so helpful, you can't help. We have to understand the familiarity problem, the continuity problem, and manage it properly. So it's a middle path between gradual effort and all-at-onceness, so to speak. The path of all-at-onceness, the path of sudden enlightenment, the Mahayana path, the idea of that is to take the goal as the path, whereas the gradual path takes the goal as motivation towards the path. It's differences between taking the ripe fruit as right here, right now, the ripe fruit is right here, right now, as opposed to trying to ripen the fruit. So like Hinayana, they say, is trying to ripen the fruit, gradually ripen the fruit. Whereas Mahayana would be saying, the fruit is already ripe. It's already ripe. Just taste it. Now, which is true? They both are. Both and neither. It's the fruit is ripe, but we're not, insofar as our continuity fear, pragmatically. Theoretically, we are ripe. Okay, but pragmatically, the continuity fear is like, we're like frozen. You know, we can't eat of the fruit. We're created to eat of the fruit, but we can't eat of the fruit because of the continuity fear. So it's, you know, they're both right, but they're both also kind of missing the point in a certain way. And what are they missing? The continuity fear issue. So Hinayana is stressing the continuity fear issue in a certain way. Mahayana says, no, forget about it. Just go quickly. Well, they're both right. I would say a better way of saying is they're both right, but a little tweak maybe is in order. You can do it in one lifetime. You can do it fast, but you can only do it fast by successfully managing your success on the path by going slower. You slow down to go faster. And so it's a combination of both of those paths, actually, that works best. This is what I see. So they're both to be valued and honored, and Catholicism, Protestantism, all these paths are to be honored. But I think it's a genius way of using both of them in the best way. You have to be a genius. Everyone's a genius. It just we all use it in different ways. But if you use your genius in a spiritual pathway, you can see, okay, that these habits of discipline, all this stuff is important. It's all important. But so is going fast is also important. So how do you do both? And the answer is full stop in the wow, this practice. This is how you do both. Now, I'm sure that the Mahayana teachers, they understand this too. I mean, I'm not saying anything that someone doesn't understand. But it bears re-emphasizing. Okay, it's very important to re-emphasize this. And this is what Buddha did. He just re-emphasized this. There was all sorts of practices when Buddha came into the world. And all sorts of... Yeah, he said, hey, wait a minute. Okay, let's not go to extremes here. Middle path. It was really taking the best of both paths. This is the fastest way, actually. It's the safe, sure way. And that ends up being the fastest way. Sure, there might be a few because of their previous... efforts who can do it real fast right now, and then everybody thinks, oh, that's the way I'm supposed to do it. No, they may have taken many lifetimes to get to that point, and you may not be there yet. But so you got to be very careful about this sudden awakeningness, thinking that, oh, it's that easy, how come I can't do it that way? And on the other hand, you got to be very careful not to stall out and go too slow. Okay, so it is this tricky middle path you have to walk across. Okay. And this is Longchenpa came to me across this great ocean of samsara, of absurdity and error, because he walked across it on a very narrow path. I saw there's a very narrow pathway that he was walking across this great ocean to come to this world and answer my prayers. I just made an open prayer to anyone who wants to help out, and he showed up. Didn't know who he was at the time. But I said, wow, this one's very, very impressive. He walked upon a very narrow path. So Jesus says the gate is narrow. Okay. You cannot get pulled into either extreme, trying to go too fast or too much lethargy, too much robotic habits. You know, just, okay, I'm just trying to be a good person and that's it. Catholicism is going too slow right now. Protestantism is tending to going too fast. All right? And they've both gotten stuck in this extremism. They really have. I can tell you this. I'm very tuned into all this. I'm going to Catholic Mass soon, right now, today actually. They're stuck in, they're in too slow. They're going too slow. I'm 100% sure of this. They're going too slow. And Protestant evangelicals are trying to go too fast. And so they end up, you know, getting over emotional. The key to solving this is full stop in the wow, where you alternate going really fast and then consciously, purposefully slowing down, not into all this habits of action like Catholicism is advising, but into just commitment to no action for right now. I'm not going to do anything. And you allow yourself to be shocked by the revelations of success, and you realize you're not maybe functioning optimally, and you say, that's okay, I'm not going to function for a little while, I'm just going to sit here quietly. This is how you avoid these two extremes. And the Mahayana Buddhism, like the Vajrayana also, they try to force the issue a lot. And there were the Hinayanas or the Theravadins, they tend to try and go slower. Let's not force the issue here. You know, we got a lot, many lifetimes to get this done. Both have some validity to it, but the real validity is what Buddha said, the middle way, the middle path. So they're not quite practicing what Buddha said to practice, actually. Okay, not really. I'll be ready.
It's 5.
And not really practicing. 5, good. Yeah, reduced intensity zone, 5th dimension. And the Protestants and Catholics, same problem. And the ecumenicalness that's happening there is to say, let's just all kind of bog down, okay. And then when that happens, the evangelicals got even more hyped up because they feel that they're being cut off, right? And so it's causing this very bad polarity, and it's showing up politically and very badly. We certainly can accelerate our path, and we certainly want to accelerate our path, and it has to be done every day, carefully avoiding these extremes, and yet utilizing the extremes in the right way of this intense practice where you give yourself time to cool down from it. Full stop on the wow. You bring up this wow, you push, you see, oh my gosh, I really can be free, I really am free, oh my, and then you intentionally back off of it and say, okay, wow, that's great, let me just sit here and let this sink in. You don't go into emotionalism. So sure, I said, Jesus, Holy Spirit, Jesus, Holy Spirit. That would be evangelical Protestantism, right? I mean, this is, they're fired up, which is great. We're not criticizing here. I'm not critical of evangelicalism and the Protestantism at all. I think they're doing a lot of really, they've done a lot of great stuff, a lot of great push. Okay, the urgency, great urgency on there, and it's been very helpful. I'm just saying there's this tweak here where you've got to know how to manage it properly. And so I do that and fire up and get this tremendous grace coming in, and then this perspective dawns upon me of this brilliant clarity. It's like, oh my gosh, I can really help out. But then I say, wow, okay, wow, let me not lose myself in this success. You can get lost in success. The success is so great, you can get lost in it. You just back off and say, wow. Okay, great. So in a funny way, you know, if you went to like a Protestant service and evangelical service and then go to Catholic Mass, it would help balance it out, actually. Because you go to a Catholic Mass, you're just like, oh, wow, okay, I'm just cooling off here. It's a cool down time, okay. They try to put a little music in it to pep it up, you know, but it is nothing like the evangelicals who really get after it. I mean, they are fired up. They say, Jesus, come right now. We're ready to go right now, which is great. But they don't understand the continuity problem. So they just spin their wheels in this come right now emotionalism without letting the dawning of this vision of the totality of it and realizing, cutting through the absurdity. One has to remain very humble and calm and quiet to absorb the shock of this to our continuity, because we've been afraid of the abyss for so long. To see that there is no abyss is almost like an abyss to us, okay? It's very important to hear this. When we see that there is no abyss, it's as if there were an abyss, because our expectations suddenly, poof, you know, it's like an abyss of expectations. I expected an abyss and there isn't one. Oh my God, that's an abyss. You know, I feel like, you understand this freak out that we have. It's very crucial to hear this. And when you start getting this, you are on a different echelon then. When you start to see this, you just say, wow, this is real fundamental progress I've made. It's very important realization. And then you have to manage that. Wow. You've already said, Jesus, Holy Spirit, Jesus, you already fired it up. They don't need to fire it up again right now. They're not going anywhere. They know. They know you're making this progress, okay? Now you need to be calm. So it's this blend of fervency and tremendous rest, full stop in the wow, composure of just letting go of all concepts, including the concept of fervency and prayer and everything. And just resting in that. This is what enables us to go the fastest. This is the fastest path. The fastest path there is. Which is what we're looking for right now. So it's, you know, the Aesop's fable of the tortoise and the hare. Really, to put it in the clearest terms possible, neither one wins the race. It's the combination of the tortoise and the hare that wins the race. It's a little bit of hare and a little bit of tortoise that wins the race. It's the managing of both of them that actually wins the race. What is that? Oh my gosh. All right, just a minute. This is someone's trying to really interfere with this video, aren't they? Can you hang in there? Full stop on the wow? Try it. Good opportunity for us. It's the combination of the tortoise and the hare. And this is a new habit. This is the habit we need to have to succeed in not being chewed up by the jaws of arrogance and absurdity. There's two jaws. There's the jaws of this great white shark are coming for us. Well, I shouldn't say white, but that's a camouflage. It's interesting. I'm wearing white because the Holy Spirit has said this going to help people. It's showing you're professing clear truth. And I look on YouTube and here's this new movie out, The Pop Star, and dressed all in white, you know. So they're trying to. It's amazing how clever the ego is. It always tries to usurp what God is sending to help us. Always, always. I've noticed this. To make it difficult for us to determine the difference. But anyway, we don't have to say white shark. A great shark is coming. Great black shark or great gray shark, let's say. Great gray shark. And the jaws are there. And there's an upper jaw and a lower jaw. The upper jaw is arrogance. The lower jaw is absurdity. And you don't want to get caught up in those jaws of arrogance and absurdity. And what causes this is continuity fear. Fear of the abyss. And again, seeing that there's no abyss at all, it feels like an abyss to us. To our continuity fear. And so we have to gradually thin that fear out. This is what we do. And so we could do that. There's no abyss, but we have to say, oh well, but seeing that there's no abyss shakes me up real bad. Like there, and this is what happens when you almost have an accident or something and you realize, oh no, everything's fine. Afterwards, you get all shaky as if you had the accident, right? Because you're expecting it. So there's a shock to having for our expectations not being met. There's a very strong shock to this, to our psyche. Even when the expectations we have are like terrible and we realize, oh, there's no terribleness at all, that's still a very strong shock to our psyche. And many people would rather have the terribleness happen. They say, oh good, at least my expectations are met, you know, didn't have that shock. This is true. It is the difference between those on the spiritual path and those who are not yet on it. Our wonderful siblings of the one spiritual family, some are not yet on the path, is that they'd rather suffer, you know, terrible suffering rather than not have their expectations met. They want to say, ah, see, right again. I knew something terrible was going to happen. It did, and this time's fine. So it's but those on the spiritual path have to say, no, nothing bad can happen to me. Everything's perfect. I'm going to see there is no abyss whatsoever. But I understand that's very stressful, and I have to gradually let that cool down. Gradually thin that continuity fear out, evaporate it. Otherwise, I'm going to keep getting shaken by it. It's very tough, no question. You have to be very careful with it. The accelerated path, like Vajrayana Buddhism, for instance, and in the Sarma, some of the Sarma Buddhist paths, Kagyu and Sakya and Galupa, they all emphasize this tremendous reliance on the teachers and the lineage of the teachers, a tremendous devotion to their gurus, their mentors. So this is really how they go fast, how the path of trying to force things can work. Without that, it's not going to work. It will not work the way they're trying to do it. So if the guru system breaks down, all that tantric activity doesn't work. It doesn't work. In fact, it's very dangerous. You have to have faith in your teacher, tremendous faith. When they say leap, you leap. And then they say, don't worry, and then do this, and then do this. And it's dangerous. It can be very dangerous, psychologically, really, that there could be a backlash. And sometimes the problem they've had is some of them go over the dark side. It backfires, and they had problems with that, which is why they have these protectors. They need all these protectors, these demon protectors, to prevent the interference from. There's a lot of those who've gone over. Buddhism has a problem with that. If you try to force things that way, whereas here, not having any guru like that, I had to do something that we can do just on our own here. With the Holy Spirit helping us. It's full stop in the wow. It's the safe way. It's the safe way. So I'm not saying that under ideal circumstances things cannot be forced forward. I'm saying that oftentimes we do not have ideal circumstances, and those are becoming less and less and less in the world and vanishing. And it's not something that you should just count on, so I'm going to have ideal circumstances. Don't wait around for ideal circumstances. Our culture itself mitigates against it, and modern culture severely mitigates against trying to force the path that way. So there is this safe way of doing it, which is, you might say, just as fast, but it's way safer. Perhaps it's not quite as fast. You might say, ideally it's possible to accelerate it under ideal circumstances with great faith and great teachers and lineages and support culture. Everything's ideal. You might be able to do a little faster. That's possible. We don't have that. But this full stop in the wow goes very fast. Very as fast as you can handle it, believe me. The more speed you can handle, the more you're going to get. But it's safe. It's very safe. Does not rely upon a teacher. You self-regulate the whole thing. You self-regulate it. It does rely upon your discipline. It relies upon you and your discipline, for sure. Okay. Now, this abyss, it's very simple. This is what we're... The expectation that we're going to fall into abyss, where does that come from? I've said this before, I'll reiterate it, see if I can do more clearly, is we're trying to define what God is, and this is how we try to pretend that we're greater than God. Well, God is something definable, but we're undefinable. Therefore, we've one-upped God. So, God cannot be defined. Pure freedom cannot be defined, but we're trying to define God, and we believe that maybe we have defined God in some way. Now, when we hear we need to drop definition, we say, oh, wait a minute, God is definition. If we drop in the definition, there's no God. So you're asking me to trust in God, but then you're asking me to throw away God at the same time. That means you're throwing me into an abyss. You see how the logic is here? And so at some level, we have this bad logic going on. And we're very afraid to look at this because we think it's too dangerous for us. Oh my gosh, I'm going to be cast into an abyss if I look at this. So if we believe that we have defined God, and then we say, okay, but I need to now throw away definitions, that seems to be crazy to us, doesn't it? So go, my, that's crazy. Because God can be defined, and we throw away all definitions that we're throwing away God. There's no God then. And since you're telling us we're not God, we're the Son of God, that means we don't exist either. So we don't have any cause. No God, no cause. We're annihilated. We're in an abyss. You know, this is the problem with at the root of our terror, as it were. It really terrifies us. Now, of course, it's completely faulty logic, because if we throw away all definition, that means we have to say we haven't defined God. We're giving up the definition, not as a concession, but as a realization God cannot be defined. So we're just accepting there is no definition, never has been. Therefore, dropping any attempts to define doesn't get rid of anything that's been established at all. Nothing's been established. So this is why the non-dual path is so important, is nothing has been established at all as far as definition. Nothing whatsoever. In spite of all perceptual appearances to the contrary, seemingly. We have just defined thingness and labeled appearanceness. But everything is still free. It's all inherently and still in pure spaciousness. It's never left its inherent spaciousness of that's what it is, really. Spaciousness ornamenting spaciousness, pure spaciousness. It's one way to look at it. It's the long day way of looking at it in Vajrayana Buddhism, called long day division, instead of the sem day, which is mind division. Long day is a spaciousness division, and magog din or something like that is activity division, sort of thing. They divide it always three different ways. You tend to do that. It's one way of looking at God. Corresponds to the Dharmakaya, Sambhavakaya, and Nirmanakaya, the three, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. There's ways of experiencing God in one of those three ways, right? So you can say pure spaciousness, pure awareness, pure consciousness, pure being, you know, pure grace. There are different ways you want to say it, but it's all the same. It's pure, it's, nothing has ever happened. We've never defined God. There's no definition at all. So we're not throwing away something that's already there. Therefore, nothing is changing with God. So this is what we have to keep emphasizing to help dry up, evaporate this faulty logic that leads to the conclusion that there's an abyss, that enlightenment is a leaping into an abyss. Now, there's some that might glimpse it, and then they go into the guru business or something, but then they get in trouble later down the road. They push it down the road in some way, but it comes back to them. We're looking for abidance in it, in truth, abidance in truth. And so we have to keep this discipline going of thinning this out, and keep approaching it again and again and again. You have to keep approaching this dread and looking at it more and more clearly until you realize there's nothing to dread, but then that's failed expectation, shock. So you have to keep seeing, oh, there's nothing to dread, and then, oh my gosh, meantime, everything's fine. Yeah, but, oh, I didn't expect that. Oh, that's terrible. So success tends to be terrible for us, right? And you have to expect it. Don't think maybe this time it won't be. No. Expect the shock and co-opt it by going into full stop in the wow. So this is what I've been doing. I've been having these great breakthroughs, but I keep saying, okay, great breakthrough, okay, but now the shock of the wow's there, okay, let me be patient with this. So it tends to be like, oh, you're slowing down, why are you going so slow? No, because the breakthroughs are coming every day now more and more quickly, because I'm managing it properly, you see. So it seems slow initially, but then it speeds up to the apex, it speeds up more and more and more, but you're acclimatized, and you say, there's no problem. Where those are racing up the mountain, they reach close to the top and they're just like, oh, completely out of breath, and they just go into a coma. You know, they can't go any further. Can't go any further, and it's no good. You got to reach the top. You have to. If you don't reach the top, you're in trouble. You might be gore of the dark side, really. It's trouble. So you have to say, okay, let me just, I took a nice couple steps here, and let me cool down here. Okay? It's like that. So we're just simplifying this all down, and we're not going to get buffeted by what is coming here. At least we're going to try. I mean, I'm sure we will get buffeted by it, actually. Everybody will. But we rely on the Holy Spirit and the great bodhisattvas and saints and sages and gurus and masters, etc. All our spiritual siblings, we're asking them to help us out at this time, just like an older sibling would help out a younger one, you know, that is still struggling towards maturity here. You know, come on down. You know what I mean? Or help us out 100%. Go for it. Go for it. Go for it. We appreciate. We'll appreciate it. And it'll bear great fruit. The fruit is ripe, but the eater of the fruit is still kind of frozen with this abyss fear of an expect problem of, oh, there's no abyss. Oh my gosh, what an abyss of failed expectations. We're still you know, thinning that out. And yet here comes the crisis in the world. So, great opportunity. So we thank all in advance, all our wonderful spiritual siblings who are a little bit more mature as far as their understanding of for all the help they're showering upon us, like constant showers of just grace upon us every moment now. Unstopping shower of grace. And we just thank them for this, and we're not going to get caught up in factionalism here, right? Because we're practicing full stop on the wow. Where's the factionalism in wow? There isn't any. There isn't any. Just full stop in the wow. And those who try to breed factionalism, you know, you just say, hey, I got to temporarily put them on, you know, ignore for temporarily, because that's not where it's at. It's just either profess clearly or listen quietly. Listen clearly and quietly. Okay, these are the two roles that I'm aligned with. This is how I see it. Very black and white, cut and dried. Is either profess clearly or listen clearly and quietly.